Well, thank you everybody for showing up to our panel. This is one of the better turnouts we've seen in a little while, so that's great. And hopefully we can at least convert one or two of you to our brand of psychosis, and you can build your own droid as well. So we're going to kind of start and just give you a little overview, do some introductions, and then leave as much time as possible for Q&A, just simply because that's really where the best in direction ends up coming from. Each of us can talk for hours on things that you probably don't care about right now. So the R2D2 Builders Club was founded with the intent on being a nonprofit organization or not-for-profit, period, much like the 501st. We really just want to help people build droids, and so you have your own astromech. We're a worldwide organization. We have builders in Australia. We have some really good builders in New Zealand and a big group in England as well, although the Dalek group seems to steal a bunch of our R2 guys over there. We try to generally organize ourselves into local chapters because it's a lot easier when you have questions if you could just go over to someone's house, bring a pizza, and let them help you fix whatever it is. But the club is really very nice, and there are a lot of people out there that if you're not good with soldering or you're not good with this, are happy to assist you, either walk you through the process, sit on Skype with you, and in some cases even just mail the part to them, they'll fix it and mail it back to you. So it's really intent on doing this one simple thing, and that's just help everybody get there. Not like any of the other costume organizations you're gonna find. We're not trying to do it to make the best of this, and we're not super rigid. We really just want everybody to have their own droid. So the main reason that people get into this is really up to them, but one of the most popular organizations or activities for the club is visiting children's hospitals, showing up for charity events, and other things, just to try and bring that extra level of whatever it may be, character, if you want us to call it that, to the event. We also try to organize around some events from the 501st, and some of our members are members of the 501st and various other organizations around that, because it's really cool when a stormtrooper gets to escort your R2 down wherever you're going. And on occasion, we have done R2-D2 weddings where R2 gets to be the ring bearer. So lots of fun things out there. Everybody wants to do something. There's a couple different options you have when you're starting to build a droid. Lots of different material choices. All comes down to your time and what sort of skills you have. You can start with wood and make your entire R2 out of wood. We have people that have made it out of fiberglass. You can do it out of plastic. You can do it out of aluminum. You can do it out of steel. And I don't know, if you had carbon fiber capabilities, you can go ahead and do that. It really ends up being up to you. So what we're gonna do is I'm gonna kinda turn over to each of the people here, let them give their name, why they started building a droid, and you know, kinda why we're in this, and then hopefully we can bring it back around. So, Travis, you wanna start?
Travis, I started because actually my son wanted to be Darth Vader for Halloween last year, and so I started researching a stormtrooper costume and found that was gonna take longer than the 20 days I had. And stumbled across Astromech and started researching that, and I just got hooked once I saw what everybody had and what they could do with it, and the way it turned out is just childhood dream. Born in 76, so grew up on Star Wars, and that's really why I did it. And it's taken me about 6 months, and that's my droid right there. He's predominantly wood, styrene, and some fiberglass and resin parts.
My name's Curtis. I've been, I started out, I was just building robots for fun, just tinkering, ripping motors out of things and putting wheels on it and making all kinds of little stuff, and I decided I was going to make something people would recognize. I decided to make a mouse droid, and a few days later I was starting prep work on an R2-D2 because it just seemed like the next logical step, and that's it.
Hi, I'm Brandon Paith. Really, when I started, I saw one about 5-6 years ago at Planet Comic Con, and ever since then, I went, I had to have one, and found out they were made out of wood frames, so I started that route, and the more and more involved I got, the more and more aluminum parts I began to acquire, and now my droid, while he's not complete, he is out in the hall, and he's 100% aluminum, and couldn't be happier. It's a great community to be with.
I'm Drew Falcons. I'm part of the 501st, so I've been exposed to a lot of the droids and things like that, and just thought it was pretty cool and decided I wanted one. And the wife said, if you're nuts enough to do it, go for it, I guess. So started working on one, and I've got pieces and parts. I've been working on mine for about 9 months, and hopefully by the end of the month I'll have him on wheels, I hope.
My name is George Westwater. I started because my kids fell in love with the Star Wars movies, and pretty much looking for something to do and get them interested and teach them about electronics and other elements. So I did this, and well, this is what I picked, and my wife probably would have liked that I chose something that was a little less intricate to start them off on. But they're having a great time, and it really is a nice hobby, and the community is really great. So we're down, that's how I got into this. So we'll go through a couple of the simple questions that always come up, just because we might as well get them out of the way now. No, you can't buy a droid. We don't sell them. We're a building organization. You can't buy a complete droid. Our relationship with Lucas is effectively completely no profit. We don't build droids to sell them. They own all the licensing, they own all the rights, they own all the copyrights, trademarks, etc. This is just purely a hobby, and hopefully for and other charity events. How much does a droid cost? Well, if we had the slideshow up and we were going through that, I'd say somewhere between $500 and $50,000. But in reality, most people spend between $2,000 to $4,000 on their droid. If you went solid aluminum, you can expect to spend between $10,000 and $20,000, depending on how much aluminum you put in it. And if you went solid wood, you'd be on the other end of the spectrum, let's say about $1,500 to $2,000. So lots of leeway and flexibility. We have people that have made them out of cardboard, out of plastic, out of garbage cans and other things. So it really ends up being up to you how much effort you want to put in. And at the end of the day, what you want your droid to look at. Because as long as it has the right color scheme and otherwise, from 30, 40 feet away, looks like R2. So if you're out at an event, people aren't really going to notice, and they're going to care. It's R2-D2. So, and the next question would be, you know, what can they do? Can it clean my house? Can it grab a soda or beer from the fridge? Can it do these various other things? Well, if you've got the skills to do that, then by all means it can. Generally, what our droids do is, most of the club sticks to either two kinds, either a static droid, one that sits somewhere, either it be an art piece, or sometimes they're incorporated into an entertainment system. Maybe they control your stereo volume, or they hide your Xbox or some other things inside of there. Or they become RC controlled. So we've got various different types of controllers and other mechanisms, and then they drive around, play some sounds, do things like that. We do have some other builders that are working on more autonomous types of droids, or ones that are hooked up to the Kinect and other elements to try and do more and more things with them. And I'm sure at some point in time, someone's going to strap a vacuum to their droid and it'll clean the house. But for now, we're pretty happy once your droid starts moving down the road there. And the last question kind of comes out to be, are there really anybody near me, or how do I get started? And this ends up being a difficult question, because 2 years ago when I started, I didn't think there was anybody around. In fact, when I stumbled across the site, I had trouble figuring out if there are people around. So I drove all over the place. I drove St. Louis, I drove up to Indianapolis, I drove anywhere I could find somebody that a builder was willing to invite me. And then I realized there was five guys here building. But great. So now we are, you know, here we are. But there is a small chapter here. Like I said, I think we have five or six, maybe seven active builders local. St. Louis has about 18. And so overall, there's about 10,000 builders worldwide. So relatively large organization. Of that, figure probably 4,000 or 5,000 are active, and 2,000 or 3,000 will end up with a droid. A lot of times people start the process and it becomes hard, or they don't know where to go and they end up stopping. So part of the club, since we are not for profit and we're trying to just do this here, if there is, let's say your droid gets complete, or if you're in financial troubles, things like that, we offer the droids back to the club first. And generally speaking, someone would rather take the droid and put it in their house in their collection rather than having it show up on eBay or in a trash can. And a lot of times we've had people that have experienced some financial issues, sold their droid back to the club or someone in the club, and then once their situation became, you know, back to stable, the droid went back to them for the same price. So really, nobody's trying to make any money here. We're just trying to keep the droids in circulation and make sure they help bring smiles to kids' faces around wherever they go. Plans. There are standard plans, and everything's available for free. They're all available in AutoCAD and PDF. For any wood workers out there, we have plans or styrene that can be blown up to the exact dimensions, so you can print them out at Kinko's on a big plotter, lay them over a piece of wood or plastic, get out a razor blade or your router, and go for it. So it really ends up being how you want to work and how you want to do that. So without going through a million other diatribes of various elements of this, I'm going to kind of turn it over to you guys, and if you just raise your hand, we'll try and get as many questions as we can, and if we run over, we run over, and if we bore you to death, then I'm sorry. Sir. Yeah, great question. We do have plenty of different droids. We have any one of the ones in the spectrum. So for those of you who don't know, as far as the ARG series astromech designations, you have R2, and the 2 actually tells you what kind of dome it is. So an R2 or R3 have different styled domes. So for example, an R7 has a still rounded dome with like a triangle eye. So various different things there. And the second portion, the D2, tells you the color scheme. So we have people that have built R5s, R2s, we've got, I don't think anybody's built the big giant square R1, but effectively there are plans for everything that, every one of those you can find, and some of them even have laser cut ready plans that can be taken care of for the domes too. We do. So generally speaking, and this kind of diverges where various people's interests are. For example, I couldn't draw a stick figure that looked normal, and I can barely cut a straight line. But electronics are my thing. So my electronic build is going to be different than the standard club build. But generally speaking, most people run either the Futaba. So servo mechanics inside of it, or they use an Arduino-based system that the club has all the sketches and everything written for. So there are some standard elements out there. And for the anybody who's trying to do something more elaborate, currently the standard is either an old notebook or netbook inside running Microsoft Robotics Studio. So lots of options, and we've got a lot of really good electronic engineers in there that can help out. As far as C-3PO, no C-3PO robots. We do have two people in the club that I know have C-3PO suits that fit in them still. It takes a very specific body type that is not mine to fit inside of a C-3PO suit. Yes, ma'am.
Well, I currently have messes on three floors of my house, basement, main level, where the garage is, and the top floor, and I have to clean them up now that he's done. But I think it spreads throughout the house to wherever. It helps to have a designated area to be able to separate all your parts and not get them mixed up, because I know I go up and down the stairs a lot looking for where I left this piece, that piece.
You have an apartment?
Yeah, well, my wife and I live in a pretty small apartment, and when I started on R2, I took over the kitchen table, and honestly, it's been more than enough space. I'll move to the living room floor, kitchen table, take some stuff outside, but honestly, it doesn't require too much space at all, as long as you can keep everything nice and neat.
You know, it's funny he mentions that with the kitchen table, because I moved into my apartment last May. And 3 days ago was the first time my kitchen table had nothing on it. And I still haven't had dinner there. That's the amazing part. But yeah, I mean, it's a very, very small space. With that said, when I do painting and stuff, I typically take it to either a friend's or my parents who have a garage so that I can take it inside. But yeah, it doesn't take much.
I've got a separate shop along with my dining room table, much to my wife's dismay.
Mine has exploded over every particular area that my wife will let it. So, but for those of you who don't have a lot of space, there are plenty of people that work in smaller spaces than most of us would consider. We have if you've been overseas and seen some of the smaller apartments you can get in Japan and things of that nature, we have plenty of builders that are able to successfully do it there. Now, my suggestion is, if it's something you're trying to get into, check around and see if there's a local hackerspace or something similar, because they might have a lot of the equipment that you don't have. In addition, they oftentimes will let you keep equipment there or other things to make this easier. And as it was mentioned, a dedicated space really does help, because I constantly lose parts because they're everywhere. So I might spend 3 hours looking for something that should have just been right there, but you know, the reason my wife confines me is because I'm not exactly the most organized person around. Yes, sir.
So for someone who would be starting with probably none of the required skills, what's going to be the biggest stumbling block, fabrication or electronics?
I think it's different for everybody, so I'll let everybody kind of answer here what their stumbling block was. But the starting point, I think there's generally two consensus. Either people start with the body because they want to see that large form, or they start with a dome. because at the end of the day, when the dome is finished and painted, it looks like a droid, even if the body isn't there. And to be, just so we can all understand this, and I did miss this earlier, the club does get together and produce parts. So, for example, especially when it comes to the aluminum parts, not everybody has a workshop that can mill all this aluminum. So we'll get together and do what's called a part run, where we'll try to get 200 people, 300 people interested in a part. So when we go get it cut or made, it's significantly cheaper. And then those parts get distributed through the group. Now it does take longer to get these parts, especially out of aluminum, because it takes a lot longer to get the machine shop and they cost more. But things like plastic parts or laser cut parts or planned for wood parts are almost always available. And there's plenty of resin parts around for casts or the more detailed elements. But as far as stumbling blocks?
Finances would be the first thing. but my dad's a carpenter, so I had a background in woodworking. So I started with the body, the plans for the body, and started rounding out the pieces that I need for the body. And it was easy because I could get my hands on woodworking tools to do that. There are people that produce the wood body in kits. Generally, you can find a kit for almost every type of build you want to do. And then I stuck with my first actual finished piece was the dome. Body was put together, but I was waiting on other parts for the body. So the dome came. Everybody recognizes the dome. I was able to put it together, and you've got something cool to show your friends that you're working on. And worst comes to worst, you don't finish the rest. You put some magnets in it, put it on top of your car, and it looks like you've got your own spaceship.
I would probably say for me, I had trouble. I was on the fence for a long time about whether or not I was even going to make one. I think I joined Astromech probably a year before I bought a part or started anything, and I was just planning, and I would look at things and look at stuff that people had done, and I would look at it, and sometimes I would go, I could do that. Yeah, that'll be easy. That's nothing. Give me an hour, I'll do that. And then I'd look at something else and go, I couldn't do that if I had the rest of my life and needed to. And then when I finally just dove in headfirst and ordered a frame, one of the aluminum frames, and I got it, and it's all just one piece at a time, so it wasn't as scary as I thought it was going to be.
I think as far as starting out, the biggest issue is how much information you get right off the bat. When you join the forums, there's just page after page after page, and everything is something you need to know, but not right now. So it's, for me, when I first started, I probably spent 3 to 4 months just reading different things, learning what it was, what this did, what that did. And then at that time, I decided I would start building the wood frame. And my whole prognosis with this was it's cheap, it's easy, I've got the tools, I can start building it, and then buy parts later on. When I got the wood frame done, I ordered the aluminum dome, which took a very long time to come in. And then by that time, the wood frame, I was like, no more, I want the aluminum one. So I had to start acquiring other parts, and slowly but surely you realize, okay, when you see a dome, the aluminum dome we have on the end down here is what you get when you get a dome, and everything else that's on it is additional parts. And so at first you don't know that, and then it's okay, there's more parts I got to order, and more parts and more parts. And so I think the wealth of information there is, while it's invaluable, it's very overwhelming.
I'm clumsy. Very. Probably not a day goes by that I don't hurt myself in some form, so I got to be careful around power tools. but that's the big thing. I started with a wood frame. I still got a wood frame. I got lucky. I had somebody that could do it for me. I found the plans on the site. That's where I started. I started with the frame. I drew it up in AutoCAD. I'm very familiar with AutoCAD. I use it every day in work, so I was able to take the plans, turn them into something usable for the CNC machine, send them over to a guy that he did a favor for me, I did a favor for him. That's how I got started. I had to buy the wood. And that was a big thing for me because I didn't have the tools necessary. So, and that's what you run into a lot. Sometimes you'll find out, I don't have a tool for that, I can't do that. So I got lucky, but at the same time, that's where the Astromech forum comes in. There's people out there that can do that if you wanna order it from them. But it's like Brandon said, there's a wealth of information. You can just get overwhelmed. And sometimes it's just kind of like I've got ADD. I'm like, oh, I need that note. I need that note. I want that. I want that. So you're going a million different directions at once. And sometimes you got to stop yourself and think. You got to prioritize and figure out what you need and what you need for this. And I've got a lot of parts laying around that I didn't need right now, but they were available. You know, we were talking about parts rounds earlier, and you grab it because you can. You don't need it right now, but it's there. So I've got a lot of stuff laying around in a box that I, ooh, that's pretty. I don't know what I'm going to do with it. So
for me, it's time. Time really is the largest stumbling block. You, especially if you're someone who really likes to see things done in rapid succession or see progress all the time. I've been working on mine for about 18 months. Yeah, there's a lot of information. The club's been around since 1999. The forums have been up since for at least 10 years. So you're talking about a tremendous amount of posts. There's plenty of that all out there, but really the three most important things to keep in mind are going to be your finances, your organization, and your time. Everything else you can work past or someone will help you, but if you're not organized and you don't have the finances, that's going to be an issue. Now keep in mind, this isn't a sprint from almost all of us, except for some that have finished it in 3 months. This is a marathon. There are people that are still working on their droid after 10 years. So it really depends on your time period, your resources, your money, and what you want to do. And as you get more and more into this and you become more and more of a perfectionist, you might find yourself redoing the same part 5, 10, 15, 20 times. So any other questions?
I actually have another one.
Please. That is a great question. It's hard to say exactly because we don't ask for any of that information on the site. I will tell you that it's more than I initially would have expected, because at the Star Wars celebrations and various other gatherings, you get to see them. And some of the more creative droids, I think, especially on the color scheme side and other elements, have come from the women builders. I think some of them were the first to do the football themed, so their favorite football team or their college colors and things of that nature. And we do have some teenage builders as well. So people that, you know, either are doing it in their woodshop class or other elements. I think the youngest builder we have who actively participates is about 15 years old. So it really does a wide range. To give you an idea, at Star Wars Celebration down in Florida, there was, I think, about 75 working droids down there, and I think around 20 of them were from female builders. Yes, more often than we'd like to admit.
Mine's not supposed to be in the house, but it is anyway.
My wife looks for anything that looks like a FedEx truck, and then that's... But yeah, it does, you know, really, with a hobby, once you start to get that sort of level of interest and the momentum gets going, it's hard not to want to do it. It's hard not to want to come home and do this, and it can be a little bit of an issue. So I just try to constantly remind myself, this is a hobby, it's not my job. So just slow myself down and kind of enjoy the process.
And you know, one other thing to remember is, even if you don't know how to do something, there are so many people, even if they're not nearby, who will literally take the time out to tell you how to do it. And you know, one of my favorite examples is my dome rotation. I had no idea. And I had a friend of mine, never met him, just talked to him through the forums. We did a Skype video chat. He lives down in Florida, and he was on video with me for 4 hours, helping me wire up my droid to get him to work properly. And 2 a.m., he finally starts going around, and you know, we rejoiced and had a beer through the internet, and you know, but it was something like that. I had no idea, but you know, they take the time out to help you. And you know, the same as I had never soldered anything prior. There's 350 LEDs in that dome, and sat down with some beers and just started going, praying it worked. And just as for a future reference, if you ever solder anything, make sure you test them ahead of time.
And don't drink while soldering. Bad idea.
That's true. There's some colors that are kind of, oops.
Anybody else, or should we continue to ramble about various other things? Yes, sir. I feel bad answering this question because it's not very good, especially when it comes to prototype fabrication. One of the things I really like about the group is they're constantly trying to improve various designs. For example, we have what used to be the holy grail of R2 designs was the 2-3-2 that we call it, where the R2 can actually go from a three-legged position to a two standing, and then the center foot retracts up inside and comes back out again. So there's constant innovation, but as all of us don't own a machine shop, the prototyping prices or even renting time and space is difficult. And the market for prototype fabrication here in Kansas City is not competitive enough for it to be completely cost effective. So we rely on some builders. Generally, Chicago, Atlanta, LA are good sources that we get some of those parts from. There are some nice shops around here, and there's a great local hackerspace community called Hammerspace here. And they're happily willing to help, and the knowledge that's down there is great. But when you need something that's made out of, you know, aircraft grade aluminum, and it's probably not the best place to go to try to learn how to do it. I'd love to see more shops be open to that, even though on small runs, and we're never in a rush, right? So if I need a prototype, I'd be happy to see it in 2 months, as long as it didn't cost me five times as much as it would have for me to make it myself. Yes, sir. Batteries? It really depends. A lot of it depends on your weight and what you're trying to do. Lead acid batteries are obviously, big car batteries are the most common. Most Droid systems run either on 12 volts or 24 volt systems, depending on whether you do a lot of riding on the carpet, which sucks down the battery power beyond belief. Now, as lithium ion batteries and LiPos and those other ones get cheaper and cheaper, some people are moving to them, especially for the heavyweight droids. If you look at a solid aluminum droid, you're looking at easily 200 pounds. So once you get up to there, every little bit counts, and putting a 25-pound lead-acid battery in there is just heartbreaking. So it really depends on how that goes. But generally speaking, it's 12 or 24-volt batteries or some system thereof. Anybody else? How does transporting it work? Yeah, that's difficult. Actually, there's quite a different ways to move the droid. the joke earlier was you could stick the R2 dome on top of your car. We do have a builder that has a cutout in his roof for his R2 to fit in there. You can either take it apart, and which takes time. So the legs come off relatively easily. trucks are nice. Vans are great. Hatchbacks are okay, but generally the running joke here is after we're done, we're all going to get together and try to figure out a way to build a droid car seat, because it's a 200-pound kid in the back seat of the car. When we do larger events, usually we caravan, so it'll be someone rents a U-Haul or they have a big truck. Mobile homes are great ones and things of that nature. We load them up and go, and there are some freight services that are relatively reasonable as long as you're willing to work within their timelines.
To get here, my dome was seat-belted in the front seat of my wife's crossover SUV, and the body sans the feet with the legs still attached was in the back on a beanbag to try and accommodate the non-flat surface and keep it from moving on me.
And there are a lot of cool tricks, actually. There's a whole section of the forum that is almost just filled with how you transport your droid. And there are people that have some really elaborate, basically boxes they've built with various straps and other mechanisms to keep them from moving around. So, any other questions? Yes, sir. Before I turn it over to the people that can talk about that, you don't want your droid out of your sight. Period. No, it's more because you're worried about someone hitting your droid. They can go really far. We have aircraft controllers. We have people who use PS3 controllers and various things. So.
Well,
a lot of that has to do with your control scheme. For example, the Futaba stuff, they don't always have a safety mechanism in them. Some of the newer Arduino control mechanisms that we're using do have some safety shutoffs if they don't receive a command in a certain period of time. But you know what? Glitches happen, and we had a runaway droid earlier, so and you can run really fast when you need to. But we have some different control mechanisms. In fact, we have a controller right here. So.
Yep. I chose to go with the Futaba 6 channel because I had it laying around. And then I actually have remote relays on the back, which don't have a great range. If I'm more than 20 feet away, they're not doing me anything, but they just do his sounds. But as the 2.4 gig systems that are for RC airplanes and helicopters, they're made to not fail. They're made to work really far away. But the other setups, the things that when they lose line of sight, those are IR, and that's basically the cheapest way to make something remote controlled right now. So that's why a lot of the RC cars and the little helicopters, if someone walks in the way, you're done, and no one's putting that in their R2. The Arduino setup with the PS2, if you want to talk about that.
I'm not sure the range exactly. He did get away from me earlier today, right for a kid in a stroller. But it seems to have decent range. It's one of the easier and cheaper setups out there. Not necessarily the easiest to program, because it seems like no matter if you're buying the same parts as everybody else, not all the code's going to be the same. So you have to deal with tweaking the Arduino code in order to get it to work for your specific droid. I'm having a few problems this weekend, but this is his first outing, so it was to be expected. And everybody's helped out with all the problems I've had. So
the XB radios are making, in some of the newer control mechanisms that are self-built, and they supposedly have over a 1 mile range in them, depending on which one you get and how good your antenna is. So the fact of the matter is you really don't want to be more than 10 feet away from your droid. And if you saw us coming down this way, usually we try to actually have someone else next to it when we're controlling it. Tell him to build a droid, because that'd be cool. I'd like to wear the goggles. Yeah. No, that would be awesome. Most of the time, the things that limits us from having cameras in there is available bandwidth or money. I mean, most of the stuff that we're using is either Bluetooth-based or relatively low in the radio spectrum, so it's really hard to transmit live video. He must be using something really high in the radio spectrum or even cellular for communication. Which obviously increases the cost, but you know what? Now I'm going to go try and find that, because I want to be able to put a headset on and look through my droid. Yeah, I think that's bookmarked, and they've gotten more of my credit card share than I'd want to go through as well. Any other questions? Yes, sir.
My wood frame sucked. It's not that it's bad, it's I did a poor job of cutting it out. It needs to be really accurate, and for like your circle pieces, you'll want to use a router table, measure it, and make sure it's good. I attempted to use the jigsaw and sand. I quickly realized I hated sanding, and with the more aluminum parts I have, the less sanding is required. So when the time came, I realized it was either make another wood frame or just go for the aluminum. It was more cost effective for me, because I was tired of messing with it, to just get the aluminum frame. And aluminum frames, I think, and don't quote me on this, but I know that like the cheapest aluminum frame right now, I believe, is $335. I think it's around $150 for a CNC'd wood kit. So for a little over double the cost, you get an aluminum frame that has, tapped holes for all of your accessories that needs to go in. It's, more sturdy. So it was, and that's not the wood frame I, or the aluminum frame I have. I went quite a bit over that. But just for me, I realized that I don't have enough patience to build the wood frame.
There's a horrible disease that goes through the club. It's called aluminumitis. You get it, it looks really cool, and you keep buying it, and then you look at your wallet and realize that all your money's gone. The point I like about the aluminum, I have an aluminum frame and I have a plastic frame, is the aluminum ones just look really cool. Now, I built two because I want one for my kids to be able to drive around that can be knocked around a little bit more. And then once I realized how much the aluminum frame was going to weigh, he's staying in my house because that is not easy to move. It takes two of us just to pick his not complete frame up. Anybody else? Yes, ma'am. It depends.
I broke mine twice on the way here.
Generally, no. I mean, they're pretty resilient from normal usage. Some of the joints, if they're depending on what material they're made out of, don't stand up quite so well. So if you saw us coming down this way, we actually picked it up over some of the larger bumps because it just doesn't, that amount of rattling doesn't always do very well. Even on the solid aluminum droids, it can shake some things loose, especially some of your electronics if you don't have them really well mounted in there. Normal wear and tear usage is pretty good, but frankly, we just freak out because we have years and thousands of dollars in these things. So someone goes to reach over and grab a part, you're like,
And I should mention that the two brakes on mine, he fell out of the seatbelt. Twice. I couldn't believe it. But everything that did break, I use silicone to attach most of my accessories. I love silicone. It's clear. It holds really well, and if I ever need to remove it, it's fairly easy to remove. So when I say break, it's more of like parts that were siliconed in decided to go flying across my truck. So it didn't take much Friday evening to stick some more silicone on there, tape it in place, and now he's good as can be.
There's a few parts that are particularly vulnerable. The foot shells are, because they're really ornate, and in order to get the amount of mechanics inside of there, they're pretty thin. So those are particularly fragile, or they're made out of steel and they're crazy heavy. So that, and some of the more detailed items on the dome, if they have servos behind them, like if the eyes were moving, then yes, you could do damage if you grabbed them. So for larger events, when we're more organized than we have been today, we try to keep at least a person standing with the droid. It's okay to, you know, take pictures, that's what we're here for. It's okay to touch it nice, but grabbing it and spinning its head around will probably give someone a heart attack.
It's like saved by gold.
Yes, ma'am. None of our droids here were complete enough to take down there, and the flight cost last year was so economical that a lot of people chose to fly versus driving their droid down, because it actually was the for some reason Southwest was just offering killer deals down to Florida. But usually what happens, especially around Celebration, is we set up caravans. So we have a couple people on the California coast and Washington that will plan routes that run through areas with other droid builders, and you chip in for some gas money, you load it up on in their truck, and they drive it. They get there, you take it out. It's really the one thing that had me worried initially when I started this was how good the community was gonna be and whether or not it was gonna be really supportive. It's frankly amazing. I've never seen anybody that doesn't get along when they get together. I mean, it's complete, you know, just geek session when you're there. You know, oh, that's awesome, show me I did that. And nobody's really hiding anything from anybody. It's all, we just want the coolest thing ever. So Celebration for me was great because there was so many droids, and we gave clinics to each of to everybody, and those are all videotaped. And so we have archives of video on different presentations on how things work. And And this year there's the second, hopefully semi-annual DroidCon, by which a whole bunch of us get together and take over a hotel in Indiana somewhere and get to drive our droids around there. So and there's regular builder events. I mean, we all try to get together locally, and sometimes there's regional events too that people try to get together. If you haven't seen, we have nice little posters about our droid races, which is a lot of fun until your droid crashes. And someone always does, but you know, then everybody fixes it. I wasn't there, but a couple years ago for a celebration, I was told that one of the droids had a nice fall down some stairs, and almost everybody stayed up the whole night, and they put it all back together by the next day. So it's a pretty amazing group. Anyone else? Not at all. Not too many questions. We have someone that has a nice model set of rockets that come out that actually you can move and things of that nature, but I don't think anybody really wants to stick rockets on it, although I have seen it on the Discovery Channel on the monster rocket something or another that was there, or maybe it was the Sci-Fi Channel, I don't remember, but someone built a really simple one and then strapped some rockets on it. He just probably wouldn't land very well.
My favorite thing is, of course he'll fly. Once. You're done after that.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, we have a taser. And someone's working on a buzzsaw. I don't know why.
We do have a buzzsaw.
We do have a buzzsaw? Does it work? Oh, yeah. I don't know why.
Like it dangerously works, like excessively works.
And we have people that have a really beautiful replica of the little shocking device that you see come out. And we have some people that have stuck real tasers in there. Again, I don't know why. But it's your droid, you do what you want, and it's your responsibility when your 5-year-old shocks themselves and falls over, I guess.
And the thing is, the club works very closely with Lucasfilm, and in fact, I mean, what you see over there is what's in the movies. ILM gave us their droids, gave 10 builders their droids, and they went through and measured every single thing. So this is as close as you can get as to what's in the movies. And in fact, anytime you see George Lucas out and about and there's an R2, it's somebody in the clubs. They don't use their own, they use ours. And George Lucas has said on many times, where were you guys back in the 70s? Because ours are better than what they had.
And since the parts were hand-selected, generally, we like to say that it's more screen accurate than screen accurate, because George Lucas actually picked, this is what I want for the CPU arm. This is the part I liked for this. So it's all completely measured and gone that direction. Sir? We're not trying to rock any boats. Just keep ourselves quiet in the corner. And in all reality, it's unlikely that anything will happen, because the amount of charity work that we do and the amount of events that we show up, there's only two original droids left from the movies. One is in the Smithsonian, one is in George Lucas's ranch, and the other is the other droid that is part of that franchise is one that ILM built. And of course, with a large special effects company, you can't stop it easy. There's cost well over $100,000. It's made out of carbon fiber. They don't even take it out of the case anymore. So it's much easier for them to call up one of us, and maybe ours gets knocked over by a kid trick-or-treating. So it's unlikely that we'll be affected, just like it's unlikely that the 501st and other people will be affected. It's just too much of a fan-driven organization. Any other questions? Yes, sir.
I'd like to see mine done. I've been on almost 2 years, so for me, I'm at the point I just want him to be done. And then back to the long what he was saying about parts I have that I don't use. I paid $330 for a periscope to pop out of the dome, and then about a couple months ago, I was like, I'm never going to use that damn thing. It's just going to sit there, and I've had it for almost a year now, and I'm at least 2 years away from ever needing it, and I just sit there and go, man. But I'd like to see my periscope be used one day, so.
One quick comment, you'll never lose money on a part. The club if you put a part up that you've gotten, just put it up for the cost that you paid for it, it's gone. I mean, it, especially if it's aluminum, they're gone within minutes. Everybody is working on a droid or more, and it'll go.
Yeah, I work with that. I'm like, Brandon, I don't see mine running around the house. I wanna run the dog over, you know? As far as anything special, I don't know. I think it'd just be cool just to have one finished. I don't have any children. My wife and I don't have any children yet, but my friend does. And, you know, just seeing a kid smile, you know, that was part of, you know, getting a Stormtrooper uniform, just seeing the kids are just fascinated by it. So it's going to be the same with R2, and I think that'll just be, that'll make it good for me.
I love adding stupid stuff to my droid. I absolutely love it. I've rebuilt my electronics bay so many times, and every time he gets something else that he really doesn't need. He's got, right now he has two cigarette jacks, so my wife can charge her tablet and phone, and he's got a guitar input because he already had an amplifier for his sound, so I gave him a guitar jack, and he even has Bluetooth, and every time I just keep adding stuff, and I'm hoping to one day have one of those droids that has a ridiculous number of arms and gadgets and things sticking out everywhere. Every time I see them, I get so jealous. I'll get right on it.
I think for me, I initially started out with the intention to make a static droid, two legs, home theater display, just for my home theater to be a cool prop in my home theater, and this is my upgrades. This is what I ended up with. Just once you see one driving around and see how impressed, like, plenty of people came up to take pictures today, and then you move the dome or you move him, and they jump back like, oh my God, they just thought it was a display, and it's just that was what got me. I didn't have an aluminum bug. I just got impressed by being able to figure out myself how to get him moving and make him seem more realistic.
I don't really think that there is a particular droid or set of droids that really stand out from the rest of them. Everybody has done something different and unique, and that's really one of the things that's cool. Even people that have stuck as close together, they might have done a paint job that's nicer, or their, you know, color schemes or their weathering job and all that was nicer than, you know, so it's always bits and pieces. For me, I want to figure out how to fix my fog machine so it'll fit inside the base so I can feel it's just have smoke bellowing out. But yes, ma'am. Well,
that's the kid in the stroller.
If you go on YouTube and you look for R2-D2 crashes, when we've generally stopped doing R2 drag races because they can get going fast enough that they just topple backwards. Generally, I think we probably try to keep them under 5 miles an hour, but the motors that are in some of these are ones from scooters that ride children around, or some of the larger ones have from wheelchair motors or hover around. So it's a pretty good amount of power that if you really wanted to, you could probably get them up to a pretty dangerous speed. I mean, it's a 200-pound bowling ball coming at you.
To add to that, something to consider, one of, I would say, hands down, the most popular motors to actually get him moving are just scooter motors off of, like, a Razor scooter. And most of those go around 15 miles an hour. And that's like, I don't know how fast people can run, but that's really fast.
That's light speed for a droid.
Yeah, that's enough to go off some sweet jumps, and he's not going to land.
If we're picking it up over a bump, we probably don't want it to be hitting 5 or 15 miles an hour and then hit that. It's just the same. Any other questions? I tell you what, you can come by the booth, and we'll get you an R2 stamp and some stickers, and you can ask your question then. All right. Yes, sir. We have plenty of them in the booth. Actually, where we are, we're over by the celebrity area if you guys haven't seen us over there, but we have the full progression of droids from what the actual shell looks like, and then as it goes up, and we've got some internals there.
Come by, I'll pull the head off of mine, you can look inside.
Yeah, the head. Yeah, we pull the head off. But Travis will pull the head off and show you inside.
I can show you what it looks like. No electronics in there.
Yes, ma'am. We do have some droids with projectors in them that do that. The holographic technology really just isn't there. The closest we can get is usually a nice, really good fog machine, dense fog, and then a projector, which looks kind of cool. But there's someone, I probably get it wrong, but I believe he's in Atlanta that does some work with some of the vets or anybody who's actually overseas in the military. And anybody who lives in the area, he'll try and contact, get them to record a video, and then he'll arrange dinner with the family and go there and project on the wall an image of their father or their mother overseas saying, you know, whatever it may be, and then they eat dinner together. So, you know, R2 did for dinner, and there's some YouTube videos of that as well. That's about as close as I think we've gotten.
We also did have one builder that cast a clear Leia out of resin and then put LEDs beneath her, so it kind of looks, it's clear and see-through, with but then it kind of glows blue, and he could set her in front.
Oh, I haven't seen that. That's cool.
Yeah, it was what's his name, Gorilla or something, with all the arms.
Yes, sir.
About how long does the charge on it last?
How much money did you spend on your batteries?
this is the first time I've had them out. I've got two 12-volt, 18-amp-hour batteries in them. They're wired up for 12 volts, so I've got 36 amp hours essentially, but I charged them overnight last night to make sure I wouldn't have any problems. One of the St. Louis builders that's here, he said he runs a full day on an 18 amp hour, so two would last 2 days. I think 18 amp hours.
It also depends on how much you're driving them. I mean, right. During that time period, especially to show, we're not always driving them around. What you have to figure is it's best to keep a charger somewhere. So if you are doing a lot of, or double batteries. You know, if you're nice enough and Amazon has got a great deal and it's a flash deal, you just buy yourself a double set of batteries and just keep one extra. Yes, ma'am. What does the drive system look like? There's a couple different design styles. We have some that are, two or three workable designs that are chain driven, and then we have a few that are belt driven. It really depends on which material of the droid you're trying to move and how heavy it is. Kind of determines which one you're choosing. And there's usually a fair amount of continued research in that area to work through and getting them to work a little better. Some people, you know, trying different gearing ratios and other things to do that. But when you look under the covers, it's pretty simple. There's a big motor, big chain or something, another wheel. So. Yes, ma'am. Builders die for that yellowing look, that aged look. There's the, oh yeah, it's the weathering element and that age, the patina or whatever you want to call it, is generally really desirable. However, the plastic that we use, it all comes down to how good the paint and how well you sealed it. From 10 feet away, you can't tell the difference between, at least on the body, the dome's a different story, the body from a plastic droid to an aluminum droid. You get close and you can notice, but they're pretty good. The amount of effort and time that people spend in trying to age artificially their droid, they would be very happy if it sat around for 10 years and that's the plastic they could use. Any other questions? You can build smaller scale. The club doesn't generally build them. There are people that build them. We have some excellent model builders. And I'm sure that as the plans were originally coming out, they were started off small scale. The plans will scale down just fine. You're just not gonna likely find any parts that from the club that can produce it. But it's, I don't see any reason why you couldn't shrink them down to whatever you wanted to. Any other questions? Yes, ma'am. We do have someone who produces that are black anodized and blue anodized. It costs a lot more. But and we also do have some builders that do amazing powder coat paint jobs too. So yes, I wish I had a black anodized one because it's just really cool. But yes. All right, let's see here. Well, we're running a little bit over, and if there's any other questions, if not, I'm going to say thank you very much for coming out and listening to us talk for the last hour. We really appreciate it.